Hello and welcome back to our channel Forensic Science Public Desk India. And now we are going to learn about forensic facial reconstruction. This is lecture number 26 of Forensic Medicine, UGCNET Forensic Science. Let's proceed into the topic. Introduction: Amalgamation of artistry with forensic science, osteology, anatomy, and anthropology to recreate the face of an individual from its skeletal remains is known as forensic facial reconstruction or forensic facial approximation. So here the main sources which we need is the skull and the knowledge of artistry, and then we can develop a face based on the skull structures and its developments and the degradements which are present in the skull. Then there are two types of reconstruction techniques. One is 2D reconstruction, which involves sketching and computerized techniques, and we are having 3D reconstruction, which involves claying and computerized techniques. So in both of them we can use computer techniques or computer softwares to rebuild or reconstruct the face appearance. So here we can see in the bottom both few images are there. So the first image is indicating the computerized technique, and this image is the facial reconstruction by claying. So clay is used in this, and this one is the 2D reconstruction where the image and the skull image both are being imposed on each other, superimposed on each other, and seeing these features the photograph has been matched and the development is done. History: Reproduction of facial features from cranial remains was first done by Wilker and His in 1883 and 1895. So he is the His and he is Wilker, and Gerasimo in 1964, techniques were later used by his students to help in criminal investigation. So this person used to do it on paleoanthropology. Paleoanthropology means developing the facial structures of the Neolithic age human beings or humanoids, etc. So then we are having another anthropologist, Wilton M. Krogman, very famous person. So he has popularized the facial reconstruction in forensic field. So he has done this work in 1962. Krogman represented his method in detail in his book on facial reconstruction, and this particular book is also referred today as well. So he is the Krogman. Two types of identification methods in forensic anthropology are circumstantial evidence identification and the positive identification. So in forensic science, if we don't have any evidence, any important evidence is not there, just we are having with the skull, there is no photograph, there is no videograph, nothing is available, only skull is available, as like in the mass disasters or decomposed bodies or whatever it is, whatever the case might be, if we are just getting the skull, cranium and bones, if we will be able to reconstruct it just forming the skull and maybe identifying by placing the soft tissues approximately, and just saying whether it is or not, we will be unable to identify. So that's a thing. And positive identification means we need accuracy in this. So when particular and specific set of characteristics fits with individual's biological profile, then it is termed under the positive identification. Correspondence of skeletal remains with the dental record, medical record, postmortem or antemortem records, DNA records, DNA analysis, all these things will be correlated to the formation of face structure, whatever it is, or we should be having the photographs to superimpose and positively identify the person, whether the skull is belonging to that person or not. So this is called as positive, and circumstantial means according to the luck or the artistry, whatever it is involved. So a biological profile of a set of skeletal remains collected is established when an individual fits the biological profile, then it is termed as circumstantial identification. That means there is no involvement of other evidences. 2D facial reconstruction is one of the method which is a part of facial reconstruction, where there is only requirement of photographs. If there are any previous photographs, they'll be taken and the skull will be taken, and both will be placed on each other, and we'll see what are the parameters to be considered, and they will position it in a proper manner so that it will get superimposed one above the other. And the same technique can also be learnt again in superimposition. So here sometimes we will be getting the skull, And without photograph also, we will be drawing the soft tissues and filling the tissues onto the skull, and reconstructing the face is nothing but again called as 2D facial reconstruction. So in 2D facial reconstruction, sometimes we may not be having photographs which will be taking us to circumstantial identification of the person. Then forensic anthropologist and artist both have to work together, then only the possible facial reconstruction will be possible. Then the method was developed by Karen T. Tyler in 1980s. So he is the person who has developed this method, 2D facial reconstruction. Just they will take the photograph or x-ray of the skull and they will develop the possible face of the skull. Involves unidentified skull tissue depth markers were adhered, and then it was photographed. First they will take a skull and they will mark tissue markers, that means tissue depth markers will be there like this, they will mark it, and then they will take the photograph of this particular thing. They will take the photograph and then they will do the development of the face. So whatever it is present inside the face, everything will be developed. Then lateral photograph prints are used as foundation for facial drawings done in transparent vellum. So the same things will be, they will be forming basically the nose, eyes, mouth, etc. These things will be designed first and this will be drawn first. Then after that they will be changing the hairstyles, they will be changing the beard, mustache, or they will change the volume of the face, they will increase its size or decrease its size, and they change the age of the person. There are so many proximities that involve in facial reconstruction. They will see all the possibilities. Then if they are having any evidence of a person appearance who is missing, if his appearance is there and we suspect it to be somebody's skull or something like that, if there is any lead, then we will be able to match it with this particular reconstruction phase in various types. There are two important softwares which we need to remember. One is the face and other is CARIES. So these are the two softwares which are used by the anthropologist and artist to reconstruction the face, suspected face, or from the skull. 3D facial reconstruction. There are two types of 3D facial reconstruction. One is sculptures made from modeling clay and other different materials and high dimensional 3D computer images. So there are two techniques in 3D. One is using the modeling clay. So they will place the clay, and very good gallery. I'm going to show you how the clay will be used for 3D facial reconstruction. For this purpose, basically we need to have the skull, cranium, all its bones together, which are pasted, and we'll see what is the step-by-step process for this particular reconstruction. And we need a particular platform which is flexible and movable in all the directions, so that we can fix the muscles which are required, heart tissues and also the soft tissues, onto the skull properly. We need a flexible and movable kind of platform, on that the skull will be fixed. Then the sculptures are made from the cast and cranial remains. Then manipulation of scanned photographs of unidentified remains, stock photographs of facial features, and other reconstructions is carried out using the computer programs. Once we get the basic skeleton, that means basic appearance with the heart tissues and soft tissues, then we can take the photograph of that, and then we can use computerized techniques where we can change the hairstyle or beard or something, whatever I have just said. In 2D facial reconstruction, all those things will be included onto the face. Here we can see the reconstruction. Actually the particular reconstruction will be done either by doing claying modeling or etc., or directly we can introduce the skull structure into the computer, and then we can use the development of tissues, younger face, or it is adult face, or obese face, whether he is adult or adolescent, or whether he is old, and if he is old, he is having beard or not. All these possibilities will be checked in the computerized techniques. Superimposition. This is a nothing but we should be having, as like we have discussed in 2D reconstruction, where we will be having a skull and we will be having the approximate photograph. So if we are having these two, you can see in the first image. So here the face and the skull are superimposed. Two images are there. One is highlighting skull here, this one, and another is highlighting the face. So both will be positioned in such a way that the face will be completely aligning with the structure of the skull. So An X-ray of a skeletal remain is placed over the photograph of individual suspected of belonging to unidentified skeletal remains to carry the forensic superimpositions. So here is the skull which is there, and on this the drawing of possible structure of face will be given. So here these are the tissue lengths. So tissue thickness are considered to be having a pins like this, and then according to this they have drawn the outline of the face along with the soft tissues, okay, then the ears and then the eyes etc. All these are placed in proper manner, and then they are checking whether it is matching with the skull or not. If it is matching, there is a possibility that the skull is belonging to that girl or not. Steps of facial reconstruction. So first we need to have all the bones related to the skull which we want to identify, all its bones together or in the pieces. So the anthropologist will be identifying all the bones and placing them in the proper manner using the computerized technique or the traditional techniques. Traditional technique will be more complicated. Computerized techniques, some softwares will help the anthropologist to place the bone material in proper position and to approximate it to form a structure of a skull. So identification of bony pathologies. So first step is nothing but analyzing the structure of the skull and the cranium and its bones, all the bones, how they are presented and how they are positioned. We are going to examine all those, and considering those particular features, we are going to develop the tissue onto the face. So there are so many peculiarities which will be varying from one person to another person. So basically we will be able to identify what is the sex of the skull and what is the age of the skull according to the growth of the skull, and we will be able to identify what is the race of the skull. So if we are having this particular parameters basically, then considering the height as well by taking the nasal length and measurements calculations, then we can approximately design which type of skull, which type of facial reconstruction we are about to do. It is female, it is a heighted female, it is having race of American, and it is by whatever it is. So the various kinds of parameters will be considered, and what are the few individual characteristics like bone pathology, ruggedness of muscle attachments, unusual landmarks, wear of occlusal surfaces, profile of mandible, symmetry of nasal bones and dentition are main features to be focused during the examination. But examination is not limited to these features only. There are many other features which are involved. Waxing of reattaching skull bones. Waxing is a technique. We are having number of skull bones, then we want to attach all those, then we will be waxing. When we are discussing about 3D reconstruction using this clay, okay. Modeling clay is placed in nasal aperture and the artificial eyes are fit into the orbit rims. So here we can see this is a skull, and we have placed all the pins which are for the tissue development, that means soft tissue or hard tissue, whatever it is there, those are going to be placed in this particular lens. So these are called as landmarks, and then we are going to place the eyeballs into the eye sockets, that is the orbit rims, in that the eyes will be placed. Then the according to reference data, colored plastics or colored ends of soft matches and attach it to 21 mark areas after setting the cast. So these are all the various pins or called as a safety matches, and generally safety matches or plastics will be used. So these will be of 21 sites. So on various positions the 21 sites will be placed. These landmarks represent the approximate thickness of facial tissue of person of same sex, gender, age or race. So all these things will be common for one particular category. So we will be taking the references from the database and then we'll be putting it in that. Layering of the facial muscles on the cast. So when we get the skull, then there are various muscles which are involved in our face. So first we'll be getting the temporalis. So this is placed in this particular position. This is the temporalis. This muscle will be placed first, and then masseter. So this masseter will be here onto the jaw. So this is the second one which will be given. So first one will be discussed here, second one is here, and buccinator will be in this particular thing. So this will be placed then occipitofrontalis. So here the fourth muscle placement will be coming onto the forehead completely, and from forehead till the backside occipital end also. Then soft tissues of neck and cheeks will be also seen. For the neck, chin also it will be followed. So step by step development of a facial reconstruction can be seen in a small gallery. So this is the first step which they are following. So placing some soft tissues near the eye orbit, and before that, first thing is placing the landmarks. So placing various landmarks onto the skull, and then positioning the eyeball, then giving the design for this particular nasal aperture, and developing a nose. So these are the various first initial stages what are involved in this. Then these muscles are placed, that is temporalis and the masseter and the buccinator. So these muscles are placed in the second step, and lips muscles are also positioned, and then we are having frontal occipital muscle also been placed. So these are the various muscles which are developed in the second stage. Then we are having hard muscle tissues completely, those will be placed. So for the cheeks, so according to its elasticity, the muscles, hard muscles will be placed. So this chocolate brown color, all the muscles which are there, those will be called as hard tissues, and complete nose development also can be given in this particular stage. Next we are having the hard tissues, eyes are ready. Inside, many other hard tissues are there, right from the cheeks part. So all this cheek part, chin part, so around the lips, etc., all this particular part is filled with the subcutaneous fatty tissues. So approximately this particular subcutaneous fatty tissue is the main problem where the facial reconstruction will be having lot of limitation. Some people will be having unpredictable kind of subcutaneous fat, some people will be having very less fat, and on this basis we cannot predict how actually the face looks like until unless we have some lead, like photograph or videograph or something like that, and then only we'll be able to design it in a proper manner. So it is not possible if you are not having the reference, otherwise it will be like a circumstantial identification itself. So the last stage, after placing the subcutaneous tissues onto the face, we are going to place the skin tissues. So there are two layers of skin tissues which will be placed properly onto the face. Then we can see the formation of face in this particular manner. So there is no result given in this website, and this is referred from a tutorial site. Then this is the last thing which we are having, circumstantial identification of a skull by developing the hard tissues, eyeballs, and development of nasal aperture with the nose, and then we are having subcutaneous tissue, then over that the skin. So this is the step-by-step procedure for facial reconstruction using a clay technique, and we are also similarly having the techniques which are which could be done in the computer using the softwares. So limitation of facial reconstruction, it is not accepted in many of the cases, and many researchers have rejected, and many researches have been conducted, and regarding the proximity of identifying the person based on the facial reconstruction. So there are some experiments which are done using the volunteers. They have given them the skull, they said to identify the skull in the given photographs which are developed by the reconstruction experts, and in most of those cases very few were been found identical. The volunteers were taken in the range of 27 to 28 or sometimes 30-50, and the many types of reconstructions were developed by the experts using 6 or 7 kind of skulls and the craniums, and they have given the samples for identification to the volunteers, and then the results were very poor. So there are some accuracy, sometimes it goes 40-50% or 60%, sometimes it went below 2% also. So maybe it depends upon the artist who is developing the reconstruction, or the anthropologist who is assisting the artist, or the person having the knowledge of anthropology as well as the development of a facial reconstruction. If it is there, so maybe there are possibilities that the accuracy will be increased. So Variability of facial muscles is high in both structure and presence, and final appearance of face is greatly impacted by the subcutaneous fat in the face, as like I already said you. So another issue with facial reconstruction is its tissue depth. We cannot predict how depth or how thick will be our heart tissue present on the face. So thank you for watching video. I hope you have understood the concept related to facial reconstruction. And in next video, hopefully we'll discuss about superimposition.